What's the worst thing a good guy ever did in a children's movie or show? Lab rats. The dad slash inventor kept the kids in cages, and it wasn't until he married and got a stepson that they got rescued. Then everyone was all, oh well, good times. Man, I used to like that show a lot. Now that you mention that though, yeah, what the fuck? Yeah, those kind of shows have interesting connotations that never get acknowledged. Like, in Jesse, why are people bullying the son of a world famous movie director? And why do they not have any paparazzi? They live in a giant penthouse. Tinkin Peter Pan is an absolute monster. She tried to get the Lost Boys to murder Wendy. The whole film is full of abhorrent morality. I mean, that's relatively on the low end of her atrocities. She sells out Pan and the Lost Boys to the pirates because of her hatred and jealousy. In the book it's even worse because the pirates aren't buffoons, but highly competent and malicious. Smee isn't as much a lovable idiot in the original. He's a sadistic torturer whose sword is called Johnny Corkscrew because he wriggles it in the wound after shanking someone. He's described as a genial man who's not as severe as the other pirates to the kids. But he's also described as one who would stab with no offense. Don't forget Peter Pan was a monster too. He'd teach kids to fly, but never how to land. And they'd just fly until they starved to death. Yup. The pirates learned their savagery from Peter. They are grown-up lost boys that Peter wasn't able to murder in their adolescence. Why in the hell was this book chosen for a Disney adaptation? Have you looked into the other stories Disney used? Lol. They're all pretty fucked. The fat controller in Thomas the Tank Engine breaking up Henry the Green Train. A very useful cask of Montilado. For the love of God. Fat controller. Yes. Henry. For the love of God. Apostrophe. I apologize if this has already been covered, but Santa Claus is a total asshole in Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. I can understand the young reindeer making fun of Rudolph's red nose. Kids are mean and will easily make fun of someone for being different. But then Santa walks in. He could have set everyone straight right there. Explained how it's our differences that make everyone special and all of that. No. He readily agrees with everyone that Rudolph is a lost cause and even tells Donna he should be ashamed of his son's red nose. Dafuck. Until he needs him, then all of a sudden he's part of the group and useful and liked. That's some fit in or go fucking die if I ever saw it. The whole Rudolph story is basically your differences are a negative by default unless they can be exploited somehow for somebody else's gain. Pretty accurate life lesson though. Carly from iCarly was in a chat. Remember that episode where she is attracted to a guy because he stole his brother's motorcycle? And then he dumps him because he was not manly enough because he collects plushes? Skneeda's humor was so mean-spirited overall. TBH, this is so accurate. Carly has so many flaws it's unreal, but she's also like plain vanilla yogurt at the same time. Tori was the biggest piece of fucking cardboard in the entire Nickelodeon lineup of shows and characters. Everybody in Victorious has distinct personalities and traits and motivations for their actions. Tori just does things. And why is she actually the main star of the show? Kat and Jade were honestly way more likable and better singers as well. This has me rolling on the floor laughing. You're fucking right. In fact, I can't even remember anything about Tori other than that she like. Wait. Seriously. What can she do? I know she likes singing and isn't even that great. Literally every other character is more memorable. Also Carly was more memorable than her. At least Carly could be funny. If anybody can name me one consistent trait Tori has throughout the show, I'll gift you an award. Because you really can't. And even if she had, pretty much anybody else portrayed that trait so much better. I love the side characters, but Tori just fell insanely flat. I was never all that involved with Carly. And after hearing and seeing some footage of the show and Dan back quote hold her tighter, she's a fighter Skneeda. I really don't feel like watching it again. I remember that the camera dude Freddy was simping for Carly, then hooked up with Sam, who had a sock with butter, was banned from a lot of states and Europe, and had a mom that was locked up or something. The mother of Freddy was weirdly possessive and Carly her brother was cool. That's honestly all I can remember. That's basically the entire show summed up. Oh, and don't forget Neville and Jabi. Tori being described as cardboard is legit the funniest thing I've heard today. Thank you so much, LMAO. In High School Musical, when everyone manipulates Troy into saying he doesn't care about Gabriella at all, while recording the whole thing, so that she sees it. God, if I was Troy, and learned about that, I'd have quit the basketball team. If my friends couldn't stand by me, and sold me out like that, there's no reason for me to be with them. Same with Gabriella and her science friends. Of course, they didn't manipulate her into saying things she'd regret and film it, but they still thought her potentially being distracted from their competition was enough of a reason to mess up her relationship. It's a while since I've seen it. I'm sorry if I made mistakes. Oh, you're remembering it perfectly. The science crowd are assholes, and so is the leader of that clique. Even an HSM2. Gabriella was totally secure in her relationship with Troy and fully trusted him up, until Taylor stirred up drama for no reason. She was a horrible friend to Gabriella. Here's my entry to help get conversation going. In the 2005 Disney movie Chicken Little, the school bully, Foxy Loxy, gets teleported by aliens, and suffers brain damage resulting in a massive personality change. When the aliens move to return her to normal, runt of the litter stops them, saying she was now perfect. It's then implied the two become romantically involved. Let's not forget Buck Cluck being a really shit father to Chicken Little. Fuck it, this whole movie just sucks. LMAO edit. I don't think it would be remiss to say fuck Buck Cluck. One Little Slip is a good song. Though, why, out of every Disney movie, did BNL have to write a song for one of the worst ones? In Wizards of Waverly Place, the whole concept of the family wizard competition is super fucked up and immoral. Basically, when all the children of a family come of age, they compete to see who's the best wizard, and the ones who lose are stripped of their powers. Imagine if we have our kids take a vision test and blinded the ones who fail. Anyways, there was a recurring character who was friends with the main cast, who was later revealed to be leading a revolution to overthrow this system. The entire main cast labels her as evil, puts a stop to her plan, and then literally murders her at the end. Which character was the revolutionary? I remember someone was disgruntled with the system, and tried to steal her brother's powers. But I think that's a different person. No, that was her. She lost to her brother, and refused to hand her powers over. They tried really hard to frame it as her being selfish and entitled. TBH. Why should only one child of the entire family gets to keep the power, and screw everyone else? I guess it's to lower the risk of someone using magic for evil. But it's still a shit system. You can easily have someone abusing their powers to cheat the competition, and can use it for evil after the competition. Also, the wizard population will go down over time, especially if someone tried to start a war or genocide against them. No matter how many babies will be popped out, the number will be severely low because of that rule, unless the wizards are into polygamy. I think it makes more sense to make a large test to see if the child is qualified to continue using magic or not. Edit. Okay, so a lot of people explained how the one wizard child policy can be justified and how the population would not decline. Some say that wizards need to be kept in secret and hide from the humans, which was seen in the show. Others say magic is a limited resource, rather than being unlimited. So the wizards would have to distribute magic equally. It does make a lot of sense. Although the system is still a problem as it breaks families apart on who gets to become a wizard or not. As for the population thing, some people theorized that children that lost the competition could be able to have wizards' kids. Although that theory does not hold a lot of water, since we only know the father had magical kids despite giving up his magic. We do not know if he was an anomaly, since he was a true wizard without magic, or rejected wizards can bear magical children. I remember the show only having another kid wizard that hypnotized his parent, so he can do whatever he wants. And the Academy arc. I actually like the theory, since it could tie in the Academy, where the students were the children of rejected wizards being able to learn magic properly. Again, we do not have much resources on how magic genetic function. I thought it was more like a conservation of magic thing. Like there's a limited amount of power to go around. So it's a safer bet to let your most wizardry child take your powers and be more powerful than having 3 or 4 middling mages in the family. The third Hokage really had no root all living by himself. Poor. Begging the ram and man to feed him. All this after promising his dying parents that he would take care of him. He was basically the ruler of the village and let the kid live in poverty for no reason.